was the night before Christmas, when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse.
Wait!
The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hope that St. Nicholas soon would be there.
Oh, 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 oh.
The children were nestled, all snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief, and I in my cap, had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there rose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away from the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters, threw up the sash. The moon on the breast of the new-fallen snow gave a luster of midday to objects below. And one to my wondering eyes did appear, but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer. With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment he must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles, his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky. So up to the housetop, the coursers they flew, with the sleigh full of toys and St. Nicholas too. And then, in a twinkling, I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled! His dimples, how merry! His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up in a little bow, and the beard on his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a round, little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. A wave of his twinkle and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work, and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk, and laying his finger aside of his nose, and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim, ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and all a good night." The end.
So, hello. I'm just gonna just keep sipping. We're celebrating the holidays. Whether you celebrate Christmas or Yule, what are your favorite parts about the holidays?
Food.
Mmm.
All the food. That's for sure.
Okay. What about you, Sal?
Probably food as well. Wait, I'm not gonna lie. It's pretty good.
I like the drinks.
I like being around my dad too.
Mm-hmm. That's
spending time
sweet.
With family is nice.
I know that we have Todd making wassail in a bit. We have some Christmas story times in a bit.
What's the night?
We're gonna read fan fiction.
So it's not 100% Christmassy, but I thought it was funny. It's on Archive of Our Own. It is called The Dangers of Last Minute Shopping by Werepire Chick.
Werepire Chick. We see you.
The summary is the Four Horsemen, which I love that title for the four of them, embark on last-minute Christmas shopping in a mall packed with wall-to-wall people. Sal gets lost. Great. Everyone panics except Sal.
Oh, God. So we should read our dialogue then, shouldn't we?
Okay. So who do we want as narrator?
Since you found it, would you like to be?
Sure. Yes. Woohoo. Sal is a bit more excited than usual this Christmas. He's got a decent number of friends to buy presents for, after all, and three of them are accompanying him to the town over from Knockfell for shopping. Larry, Ashley, and Todd are good company. Sal genuinely enjoys every minute he gets to hang with them, even with the presents and the press and shove of last-minute shoppers interrupting their conversation. The mall they're in is packed, probably because it's the largest one in the area, and everyone else from smaller suburbs and towns come to it for their shopping too.
Wear your mask, people.
You're already there. No, I'm telling you.
Larry says empathetically.
You can't kill a Wolverine. That's his whole thing. He heals up. He's fine.
Thor is a literal god.
Ashley fires back.
He just kept hitting him with thunder until he was dust. Boom. Dead. Done deal. Right there.
His powers are lightning, actually. Todd interjects mildly. He calls himself the God of Thunder, but it's the lightning he attacks with. Thunder is just the second the sound the lightning makes. I think that's Larry again.
Wolverine could totally survive that.
Not if Thor disintegrated all his molecules.
I'm guessing that's Larry again.
I guess, I don't know.
They're allies anyway, so I doubt he'd do that.
Sal isn't much of a comic buff as his friends, but it's fun to listen to their debate anyways. He's mostly trying to remember the directions they got from the mall map. They've been trying, unsuccessfully, to find the music store for almost 20 minutes now, which is partially due to them pretending for the first 15 minutes that they didn't need a map in it to the unfamiliar mall.
That's a move.
Accurate. Oh well, the journey to the destination is half the fun.
Hey guys.
Sal starts, glancing at the signs bolted to the ceiling as they pass them.
I think we were supposed to turn. Guys, hey.
No one is listening.
Pretend I do not see.
And Sal finds himself getting shoved to the side by an oncoming woman with her three kids.
Excuse me, ma'am, I'm just...
He gets cut off as a man heading the opposite direction as the mom and kids pushes him back into the crowd again.
I'm sorry, I'm just trying to...
A group of college kids gets in his way and sweep him into their pack, carrying him even further from his friends.
Excuse me, please let me through, my friends.
Sal isn't loud enough to be heard over the bustling mall crowd, apparently, since not a single person stops to let him through.
You're like Mufasa and everyone's the wildebeest.
Oh, God! That's terrifying. Dad! Fuck! Come on!
He protests and continues to get dragged away by the flow of human traffic.
Okay, you know what? Let's let Sal decide.
Larry says, waving his hand to Ashley so she can't cut him off again.
Oh, wait.
Sally, dude, you agree with me, right?
I'm going in the crowd.
No! Come back!
Shit. They all glance backwards at Sal expectantly. Except he's not there. Larry stares for a second, uncomprehending, and then asks aloud.
It's like the numbers are going by.
Help.
Sal?
He turns in a circle, using his height to peer over their heads.
Sal? Sally face?
I just think of like that fucking Bill Hader skit. Kevin?
Come back.
I'll come back.
Come back to me.
I miss you guys. The college kids hate me.
Ashley joins in, stretching on her tiptoes and grabbing Larry's shoulders for support. I think we lost him, Todd says, grimacing as someone bumps into him. The crowd of people moving around them shoots dirty looks their way for blocking the flow, but none of them really care.
Oh my God, we lost him!
Larry says, turning in another frantic circle. He still can't catch even a hint of the unfamiliar blue hair of his friend, nor the mask Sal is wearing.
Yeah, how the fuck?
Right? It's just people and people and more people, none of them Sal.
Sal?
Ashley shouts over the crowd, cupping her mouth.
Sal, if you can hear me, jump and wave your arms.
The most of the reaction they get is confused looks and disgruntled murmurs from their raised voices.
Oh my god, we lost him.
Larry repeats an even more distressed voice. Look, it's fine, Todd says, trying to calm them both down. We just have to backtrack a little. You stay in one spot when you get lost, right? Sal's smart, he probably did that.
Right, of course,
Ashley says, and then proceeds to try and muscle her way through the Christmas shoppers. She's rebuffed for it immediately as a man with a dozen bags on his arms knocks her backwards, her shoulders hitting Larry's chest dead center. He catches her without complaint. So, this might take a little while, Todd admits.
Sal, we're coming for you.
Larry yells over the crowd and dives against the flow towards their missing friend's location.
I just picture Larry like...
Sal stumbles out of the crowd, finally, after what feels like forever. He huffs and undoes his scarf around his neck, letting it hang loose as he shoves his pigtails around, trying to feel less like he's just been run over 10 times.
Oh, the least they could do is say sorry,
he mutters, checking his prosthetic straps. They're still holding tight, which is a relief. He turns around to see what store he's ended up in. Sal blinks. There are rows of records and CDs on the shelves, one of the more recent rock songs that's been released playing on the overhead radio, and a couple of people with twice as many earrings as he has browsing the aisles. Oh, it's the music store they were all trying to find. What a stroke of luck.
Ooh.
Might as well take this opportunity to buy his friends their Christmas gifts. Sal hadn't been sure how he'd keep the three of them from seeing his purchases, but he figured he'd manage it somehow. This solves that problem before it arose, though, so he's not going to waste the chance. He decides that he'll go find his friends again afterwards. Knowing them, there's a chance they'll end up in the food court or something. It shouldn't be too hard to locate either. Larry's pretty easy to spot, even in this crowd. Sal puts his hands in his jacket pockets and wanders into the store, bobbing his head gently in time with the drumbeat of the radio.
Sal's dad is gonna kill me, I know it.
Larry says, blowing his long bangs out of his face.
Scratch that, my mom is gonna kill me for losing Sal.
We weren't even here for a whole hour. How does this happen?
Ashley exclaims. I think we're just very talented at attracting disasters. Todd replies.
Do you see him?
Larry asks desperately.
Turn around again, maybe he's down the other hall.
Larry turns carefully, working hard not to overbalance and drop Ashley, who is sitting on his shoulders to get a vantage point, while Todd circles them, acting as a failsafe if Ashley were to fall.
Why do we all have one brain cell?
Because Sal has the other one.
True.
Do you
see him yet?
Larry asks again, voice tight. Ashley isn't exactly heavy, but there are people everywhere, and he's not used to lifting this much weight for so long, especially not being jostled and bumped against every few seconds.
No, turn around again.
Larry groans, but does. Back to Sal. What's with the mask?
It's a prosthetic.
Sal replies, tone even and unaffected at the common question. Oh. The clerk stutters for a moment, a sheen of teenage sweat on his brows. Sal is used to people stopping him in stores, most of them clearly worried he's a robber or something. The clerk, though, just seems like he was hoping for a fun conversation, rather than accidentally inquiring about Sal's severe scarring. Can I help you find anything? Asks the clerk a tad awkwardly. Sal figures he should cut the guy some slack. Prosthetic is off-putting to most people. Sal's friends are just weird exceptions.
Sure. You have any Sanity's Falls merch?
Maybe. Sal lets him run over to the person working cashier. A woman who's got 3 visible tattoos, a nose ring, and clearly has worked here far longer. He takes a moment to move over to the collection of headphones, picking up a chunky pair and sliding them over his ears. The music currently selected is jazz, which isn't bad, but not what Sal likes to listen to. He flicks through the Try Me CDs in the machine and selects Metallica. Back to the three of us.
This is not clear.
Probably Ashley.
That or Larry.
He's on the short side, blue hair, scarf, fingerless gloves.
Who wants to be the security guard?
Oh.
Security guard?
The name, son.
Says the security guard tirelessly.
Sal Fisher. But, oh.
No, it's fine, just go.
But Sally Face works too, sometimes.
Security guard rolls his eyes, clearly too grumpy from the number of people in his mall, to ask about the nickname. Fucking mall cop. He presses down on the intercom on his desk.
Okay, Paul Blart.
Leaning to the mic and saying,
Sal Fisher, please come to the security desk. Again. Sal Fisher, please come to the security desk. Your friends are looking for you.
There's a chance he might have been trampled, honestly, Todd says thoughtfully. I mean, the crowds are big enough and he is pretty small.
Don't say that.
Jesus
Christ. Larry hisses. Doesn't tell us who it is. I think it's Todd again.
Yeah.
It's a realistic possibility. I'd like to have my bases covered with my expectations for outcomes.
Todd, I swear to God.
We're terrible friends.
Ashley despairs, face in her hands.
We didn't even notice he disappeared?
Security guard sighs loudly as the three of them spin circles of worried conversation. Back to Sal. You wanna do this voice? Sal holds up a finger, shaking his head harder. An Iron Maiden song shouldn't be interrupted by conversation, at least for the first listen around.
The merchandise, it's...
The clerk tries to wave his hand in front of Sal's face.
Sir, ma'am, whichever. Hey, are you listening to me?
I said hold on!
Sal insists as politely as he can. He turns up the music's volume to the point he can't even hear someone talking directly at him, let alone the ambient noise from outside the store. He flicks his pigtails as the guitar solo starts, the crescendo ripping through his hearing just right.
I'm not paid enough for this,
mutters the clerk, unheard by Sal. Back to the three losers.
Hey, you guys are cool. I love you.
Well, that's a full 15 minutes of him being missing. Todd announces, looking at his watch. He's not responding to the announcements, and we've used up almost an hour of our 3-hour shopping trip limit.
We have to send out a search party.
Jesus Larry Christ. Says, body posture rigid. He looks ready to start fighting through the Christmas shoppers again. And from how his fists are curled tight, that's probably his intent.
Po, po.
That was your idea. Oh, wait.
I don't know who says that.
This is Ashley right here.
We should have done that in the first place.
Ashley scolds anxiously.
Instead of walking in circles with me on your shoulders.
I think.
That was your idea.
Yeah, and you should have told me it was a stupid one right off the bat.
Guys, Todd says.
You would have made me do it anyway, and you know it.
I would not.
Guys. Todd repeats.
Look, we're wasting time.
Larry says.
I'll start in this end of the mall and work my way back to where we lost him, and you go on the outside and take the other entrance in. Todd will stay here and coordinate the search over the intercom.
Yeah, no, you can't do that.
Says the security guard. Guys, Todd exclaims.
What?
Ashley and Larry respond. Todd points next to himself.
Who are you looking for?
Sal asks curiously, the plastic bag hanging from his arm.
Sal!
I think
Sally!
Sal finds himself squished in a group hug very suddenly. He pats Ashley and Larry's backs comfortingly, despite his confusion.
Hi? Missed you guys too.
We're so sorry, dude.
Larry says earnestly into Sal's hair. He's got his face pressed to Sal's scalp so his breath tickles Sal.
Oh my god.
I'm not doing that.
Just eat his head.
So sorry.
Ashley adds on, squeezing Sal tighter.
Congrats on finding your friends.
This is security guard. Family.
Now go away and stop blocking the traffic already.
Sal cranes his neck to look at Todd around their two other friends.
What happened?
He asks, patting Larry and Ashley's back stills.
I was only gone for like 20 minutes.
Think about what you just said, Todd says, an amused smile on his face. Sal does. Then he thinks about the worried expressions Larry and Ashley had when he walked up to the security desk, aiming to call them all over the intercom.
Ah.
He says, putting together the puzzle pieces. His two tall friends release him finally, and Sal offers them an apologetic look. He's smiling sheepishly under his mask. They don't see that. So he puts that emotion into his words.
Sorry, guys. I didn't mean to get lost.
Yeah, it's your fault.
It's fine, Todd says, gently herding them away from the security desk. Let's just go get a move on and find the music store.
Oh, I found that already. I can take you guys there. Great!
Ashley says, and grabs Sal's hand immediately. Sal blinks at her. She gives him a wry smile.
That makes sense. Oh, wait.
So we don't get separated
again.
Sal considers that and then nods.
That makes sense.
Fuck yeah, it does.
Larry grabs Sal's other hand.
Let's not do that again, ever. Come on, Todd. Join the daisy chain!
Todd shakes his head, but takes Larry's hand. Oh.
And off we go.
Ashley says, and directs their group back to the mall. Sal laughs, partially because this is inconveniencing everyone. It wants to push between them to get by. And most because, like my son, the Mickey Mouse. It's a ridiculous yet effective solution.
Hi.
Sal says to the clerk.
I'm back.
The teenager stares at them, all holding hands in his store.
Great.
He says belatedly, sounding like he means that as insincerely as possible. Fuck you. Sal gives a wide smile so no one can see, because it matches the shit-eating grin Larry and Ashley have. And even Todd is smirking by this point.
Do you got any Sanity's Fall stuff here?
Larry asks immediately, and Sal has to figure out how to dissuade his friend from buying the gifts Sal already got for him.
That was fun and sweet.
I like the notes, though. Things friends should do more. Hold hands.
Aww. Yes.
Yes. Like, I love platonic hand-holding.
Hand it over. Hand it over.
Hand. We don't bite.
Hard.
Speak for yourself. I bite very hard.
Dogs bite very hard.
Ouch.
Say there's a salary one.
Celery.
Celery? I love celery.
I hate celery.
Yeah, it's only 2,000 words. It's not very long.
Let's do that.
The one we just read was about the same, so.
That's fine.
Let's do it. And it's Christmas?
It involves a mistletoe, so sure.
I have a mistletoe. Oh, but it's in my closet. I'm so sorry.
It's okay. We have a Yule log.
That works.
All right, so this one is called Under the Mistletoe by Faded Sanity.
Hell
yeah. Summary.
I'm going to sew this back here.
A Christmas party had begun in the basement of Addison Apartments, and some smartass had decided to hang mistletoe near the food and drinks table. After a long night of avoiding the mistletoe, Sal and Larry eventually end up underneath it. Will the long unrequited love be fulfilled, or will nerves make them tap out?
Tap in.
Okay. I'm gonna take a sip of my
Todd's like, I can't.
Gotta lubricate the vocal cords.
Gotta wet your whistle.
Gotta wet my
your
whistle. Gotta wet my whistle. Hon. Gotta wet my whistle. I can never do it when I want to.
Whistle.
Gotta wet my whistle. Gotta wet my whistle.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, that made a lot of moisture.
Lots of spit.
Hold on.
Spittle.
Got it.
There you go.
Oh, God. I was going to say, like, dogs might be coming. It's fine.
Oh.
Okay. So, all of us are in this again.
Yay.
Yay.
I guess I will begin with my narration.
Yay.
The sounds of happy chatter filled the air as cherry Christmas music echoed off the concrete walls. The Christmas party had officially begun. I just spit. Yeah,
did you just spit? Go on.
Mm-hmm.
officially begun, and everyone was already socializing with people they had never actually met. Larry sighed out as he leaned against the wall, looking out over the sea of strangers, twirling a strand of his long brown hair between his slim fingers.
Okay.
Larry! Oh.
Dude, I don't actually know about like half the people in this room.
Sal, Ash, and Todd nodded in agreement, as they also looked over all the strangers in the room, slightly annoyed by the smell and the stuffy heat. I'm gonna say this is Sal.
Yeah. I know, right? I don't exactly know many people. I mean, what if some of them are dangerous?
Sal spoke out, adjusting the claps of his prosthetic as he backed up and stood closer to Larry, who was lost in thought, still twirling his hair. Ashley chuckled aloud and nudged them both, pushing her hair behind her shoulder and crossing her arms.
Come on, guys, it's Christmas, and it's a party, nonetheless. Lighten up and enjoy the night.
Was she a ballet girl?
I don't know.
She dances on the spot and laughs again.
I'm sorry, Ashley.
Waving over at Lisa as she approaches them, a cup of what looked to be wine in her hand.
You have to be your mom.
Hey, kids, are you enjoying yourselves?
Oh my god, that's accurate. Wait, I love that.
Sal, Larry, Ash, and Todd, and Neil all nodded.
No.
Ashley swayed back and forth in rhythm to the song that was playing. Larry pushed himself off the wall.
Like this. Shake your body, don't stop, don't
and
miss.
And cracked his neck. Crossing his... crossing his arms, he looked over at his mum.
His mom.
Mom.
Love that.
None of us know half of these people. Are you sure they aren't dangerous?
Lisa rolls her eyes and laughs a little, shaking her head softly.
Well, they won't be stranger if you go over and speak to a few people. Go and say hi to some folks and enjoy the party.
Lisa waltzes off and 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and disappears into the crowd as does Ashley, Neil, and Todd, leaving Sal and Larry all alone in the corner of the room.
And they were alone.
They both look over at each other and exhale softly.
And I look at him.
And he looks at me.
Both not wanting to get stuck in the middle of the big crowd. The heat alone in the room made the boys itch with agitation.
Is it hot in here? Is it just me?
Surprise all these bugs.
Who the fuck? Wait, it's me.
I think that's you.
I suppose we better go and talk to some people, dude. It's a Christmas party after all, and it is a party, and my hat fell off. We should talk to some people.
Larry frowns a little, but easily complies. Oh, that was Sal then. Following Sal as he walks into the crowd. They venture in further, speaking to a few people, and wishing...
Oh god, I'm having a problem.
Shit, where was I?
Larry frowns and blah blah blah.
I had already said
that. Oh.
They venture in further, speaking to a few people and wishing them a Merry Christmas as they pass
Merry Chrysler!
Merry Christmas! They eventually spoke to someone is what I should say. Robert, and at least they know he's a chill dude.
You want to be Robert?
Sure. Yo, Sal, Larry, sick party ride.
Oh, I love that. Wait.
Robert smiles a little and fist bumps Sal. And Larry, taking a sip from his cup of alcohol and looking at them patiently. Robert was a cool dude.
Hell yeah.
At least to Sal and Larry, he seemed pretty chill.
I think this is lit. Yeah. This
is Larry. Yeah, it's pretty cool dude. Wish we knew more people here though.
Larry spoke out, stuffing his hands into his pockets, blowing a strand of hair out of his face.
Always.
I know some cool bros you can speak with. My friends, you've met them before, I think. Robert goes back to sipping drink from his cup as he looks around, looking out for his pals who he wants Larry and Sal to chat with.
Aww.
Robert wasn't a bad guy. They had always visited him and had jam sessions together, and he is a damn good guitarist, too.
Hell yeah.
Larry and Sal sort of looked up to him, in a way. I don't see them. Maybe they aren't here yet. Anyways, Merry Christmas, dudes.
Merry Christmas, Robert.
Merry Chrysler, Robert.
Sally and Larry wishes him a Merry Christmas, too, before wandering off and venturing deeper into the crowd.
They find Chug and Maple standing around in the back, chatting back and forth to each other, obviously not a fan of the stuffy atmosphere and loud noises either.
Hey, how are you two doing?
Sal asks, his monotone voice hardly audible in all of the noise.
Want to be Chug?
I guess it'll be Chug.
Go ahead.
It's alright, party, isn't it?
Chug says, downing his cup of soda and leaning against the cold wall.
That's Chug.
Yeah, it's pretty noisy though, and there are many people here that we know.
Larry yells out over the loud music, back to twirling his hair once again. I think this is Maple who wants to be. Do you want to be Maple?
Yeah, I can be Maple.
I can be Maple if you don't want to.
It's okay.
Okay.
Yeah, that's why we stuck to talking to each other. I'm not really up for conversing with strangers tonight.
Maple spoke in her hushed tone, hardly audible in the noise either. They wished each other Merry Christmas.
Merry Chrysler.
And went on their way, passing a few other people before Sal spots a familiar head of blue hair.
Dad?
I didn't think you would be here. What with work and all. Larry and Sal approach Henry, waving as they grow closer to him. Sal hadn't really expected to see his dad here. He had to work, like all the time, so he hadn't have...
What?
So he hadn't have, though, thought he would be able to make it. Seems like he was wrong, though.
Hey, boys, how's it going?
Sal's dad smiled weakly at the boys.
Hey, Mr. Fisher, it's going good. It's super stuffy in here, though.
Larry pulls at the collar of his tiny fall shirt, indicating that it was, in fact, extremely hot in this concrete prison. Henry chuckles and takes a swig of strain, scratching his head as he looks around the room.
The anime scratch
head
thing.
Yeah, they don't need me in right now.
No, that's not
right. Oh, shit.
Dad.
Dad, I didn't think you would be able to make it, what with work and all.
Sal questions, following his dad's eyes around the room as they land on Lisa, happily chatting away in the corner of the room.
Yeah, they don't need me in right now, so I thought, why not make the best of this time, right? Anyway, I'm going to say hello to Lisa. Have fun, boys, and Merry Christmas.
That's my mom!
He pats Sal's head before heading off towards Lisa, bumping into a few people on his way past. Larry looks over at Sal as he points towards Todd and Neil, holding hands over at the food table.
Oh my god, so cute.
They decide to go and speak to them both, weaving in and out of all the people as they make their way towards the two lovebirds. They push through the crowd and are finally noticed by the boys, who usher for them to come over, as if they weren't doing so already.
You can be Neil.
I'll be Neil.
Give us your good Neil voice.
Mm-hmm. I don't know what Neil would talk.
Give me a Neil voice.
Neil voice. How do you say like he doesn't? You don't know what he sounds like. You live with him. Come on. No.
That was wet. That's Neil.
That's Neil.
He's just an eldritch entity.
He's the endless one. Sorry.
Just Terrence. A loud yell, and that's how all his the dialogue gets. Hello guys, just a heads up, there is a mistletoe, like, right over there, so I'd be careful. Neil points to a spot a few feet away from the buffet table and smiles. I keep forgetting my narrative voice.
Hey, thanks for the heads up. We'll keep that in mind.
Sal says, crossing his arms and looking over at Neil. How's the socializing going? Todd questions, chowing down on a plate full of food he had piled high on a paper plate.
It's bogus, dude. We've seen a few people we know, though, like Robert, Doug, Maple, etc.
Larry states, Doug.
Chug.
Doug. Hi, Doug.
Chug.
Playing with his head, obviously nervous. An obvious nervousness now. Okay, sounds good. We're going to go and dance to some music. Have fun. Neil smiles, taking Todd by the hand and leading him towards the dance floor.
Aww.
Sal and Larry so grab sweet. A few pig and blankets before they continue to roam around, nonchalantly saying Merry Christmas.
Those are pretty phallic.
To everyone they pass. Larry grabs Sal's hand and stops him, finally giving in to the Christmas music and dancing a little. Sal chuckles and joins in, she's letting their fears and anxiety melt away as they both begin to actually have some fun. The party goes on for several more hours, not as crowded as it once was. Few people remained in the now dirty basement. Lisa smiles and exhales loudly. Exhales loudly. Laughing to herself as the group look over at him.
This place is a mess. Want to help me clean this up, Larry Bear?
You better help.
Lisa asks, looking over at Larry, hopefully. Sal, Todd, Neil, and Ashley all chip in.
Oh.
We'll help you clean up, too.
What the fuck?
Who the fuck said your voice cracked?
Yes, my voice cracked.
Anyway.
Lisa smiles and hands them all a black bag each, also picking up rubbish herself as they begin to clean the filthy basement floor. Half an hour passes and they have all finished. Sal and Larry had stuck together the entire night. Not really, Sal.
What?
I can't speak anymore, guys.
Now you're on my level. Doug.
Welcome to darkness.
Welcome to Doug.
Not realizing that they were standing under the one spot that they had were told to be wary of.
Jesus?
Ashley giggles.
Kevin?
And coughs loudly. Points up towards the ceiling as Sal and Larry look up in confusion. They instantly realized what was going on and audibly sigh. Mistletoe hung above them. And they would have to kiss in front of the gang and Lisa.
Okay.
Kiss, 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 touch. And soon joined in by everyone else in the room as Sal and Larry look at each other in disbelief. See you, Sal.
Oh, shit. Wait, yeah, wait, damn it, Larry. Neil told us to be careful of the mistletoe.
Sal spoke, his ears turning a bright shade of red as he was obviously very anxious.
Yeah, I forgot, dude. Oh, shit.
Larry begins twirling his hair again.
Oh, my
butterflies
God.
Butterflies turning inside him and his legs to jelly.
Wow, I can't walk.
Sal clicks his tongue and presses his prosthetic against Larry's lips. Not a proper kiss, but still enough to make Larry's knees almost buckle beneath him.
Hook up! Oh, almost. Oh.
Wait, I'm sorry.
Ash.
Oh. Whoop!
Ashley cheers in the background. As Todd and Neil hand her $20.
You have a bet on us?
Sal says, shuffling from foot to foot on the spot.
Oh, obviously, it was clear
that... No, this isn't you.
Oh, shit.
I thought it was Ash.
Yeah. Maybe it's Ash. Yeah, I think it's Ash.
Obviously, it was clear that something was going on between the both of you. I mean, Larry almost fell over there. You guys definitely like each other, no questions about it.
Sal and Larry tutted and rolled their eyes, laughing at their friend's idiocy. She really wants to be canon, doesn't she? Larry thinks, looking over at Sal's prosthetic lips and putting a hand to his own, smiling stupidly to himself.
Are these my lips?
As Ashley, Todd, and Neil say their goodbyes for the night before heading off.
You have chapstick, bro?
Lisa smiles as Sal and Larry open Larry's bedroom door, closing it gently behind them as they walk in, Larry plopping himself down on his beanbag.
What a night. Right, dude?
Larry asks, looking over towards Sal, who's lost in thought, standing at the door.
Little dude?
Larry asks again, only a little louder this time, tearing Sally right out of his thoughts.
Oh, you okay, Sal?
Sal shrugs and steps closer towards Larry.
Sorry, that was funny. Larry base?
Huh?
The kiss under the mistletoe. Can we... do it again? But this time, not the lips of my prosthetic.
Larry raises an eyebrow before hopping up, smiling happily at Sal.
Can we? I don't want to make you uncomfortable, dude.
Before Larry could speak again, Sal has already pushed his mask up above his lips and his face and was face to face with Larry.
Wait.
His eyes scanning Larry's face for an answer. Larry grins before cupping Sal's chin with his hands and pressing his slightly chapped lips against Sal's scarred ones. Sal's knees buckling below him as they fall to the ground in a big, blushing, laughing heap.
Dude, you good?
Larry questions, kissing Sal again as he laughs.
Yeah, sorry. My legs were not ready for that.
Sal chuckles, kissing Larry again. This time holding it for much longer this time. Ooh, spice.
Wow. Thank you. From the food.
Because deepening as their bodies crave more intimate connection. Larry draws circles on Sal's cheeks as he...
I draw circles,
this
wait.
This is getting spicy. Spicy.
Spicy.
Spicy. As he...
Kevin?
Kevin.
Weird little baby.
Oh my goodness.
As he licks Sal's lips, asking him for entrance, to which Sal happily obliges. And opens his mouth slightly, just enough for Larry's tongue to slip in. This is getting spicy! There's still more!
Go on!
I'm ready.
It's a Christmas miracle.
I need more drink. Give me a second.
We're gonna need more after this.
Yeah, give us a second. Hold on. Wait. What the fuck? Cheers.
Merry Chrysler.
Merry Chris.
Chris?
Cheers to all the fanfic writers out there that are completely not crazy.
Kevin?
We appreciate your work.
We love you.
We do. This one's for you.
Gizmo loves you too.
Just enough for Larry's song to explore around.
Read it.
I'm going
read
to
it. Read it.
Give me a goddamn minute!
I'm ready.
So moon softly as their tongues battle for dominance. Larry obviously winning as the kiss deepens. They soon break for air. A string of saliva connecting their mouths as they pant heavily.
Thanks, bro.
Wiping that little bit of saliva off of their mouths.
Holy shit, Sal. That was absolutely awesome.
Larry exclaims.
Bro.
Sitting back on the beanbag, still panting as he looks towards Sal, who had his lips arched into a happy smile.
Yeah, it was great. I never knew I wanted that until I had it.
Wow.
Sal laughed out in a breathy voice, leaning against Larry as they laughed together. Sorry. They had liked each other for a good while now, but had never really wanted to make the first move, just in case it would jeopardize their friendship. Aren't they glad they came to this Christmas party?
No, I hate it here.
I'm assuming this is me.
I'm assuming too.
I actually fucking love you, little dude.
Dude,
I hope you remember that for like, ever.
Larry laughs, grabbing his game controllers and putting Mario Kart into the Wii.
It's not gay, bro, it's Mario Kart.
You're right, it's not. I actually fucking love you too, Larry face.
Sal sticks his tongue out before pushing his mask back over his lips, taking the controller from Larry as he sticks his tongue out in protest, smirking happily. I think that's Larry, and then that's Sal. Larry's first, then Sal.
But.
Oh, I thought it was Sal, because Sal just took my fucking controller out of my arm.
Oh. But you. Wait.
I don't know, just one of you say it.
But can't you beat your ass in Mario Kart?
See, it's hard to say.
But I eat is what I heard.
But I eat your ass.
But I eat your ass in Mario.
You fucking nerd.
It's not gay. I got socks on. Wait. No, I don't.
I got socks on.
Shut.
She's eating the garland.
No, Kenny. That's not for you. That's for Jesus.
Anyway, what's the last line?
Last line.
You aren't fucking winning this time, nerd.
Nerd.
Nerd. Okay.
Okay.
That was beautiful.
She doesn't normally do that. That's funny. I think it's time for other festivities at this point.
Yes,
so,
please.
Let's take a break for maybe wassail with Todd.
What do we have, Todd? What's wassail?
So wassail is a Yule traditional drink. It's essentially spiked mulled cider. So we have apple cider right here. We are putting in apples. We are gonna put in more apples when I'm done cutting. Some tangerines.
Wow.
Say as I attempt to cut. And we're just gonna drop those halves in.
It's beautiful.
And then we have three cinnamon sticks.
Kapoor.
Splash.
Splash.
And then, let's see, it says, teaspoon allspice, teaspoon cloves. So, I'm going to do best guess. That's a teaspoon cloves.
A teaspoon of cloves.
Teaspoon allspice. About a teaspoon. And teaspoon nutmeg. And honestly, that's it. I'm actually gonna add this now. So this is some bourbon with a cinnamon stick been steeping in it.
Woo!
And now we wait for this to boil, and then we'll simmer it for... Don't say. We'll simmer it for a while.
We'll simmer it.
It's time.
I'm done. I'm turning this off.